retractor doesn't come in all sizes and shapes, but Chung's retractor comes in various size and shape. And for Asian women, this was quite comfortable, short neck, and then obese lady, and then stout neck, and different small, medium, large, different blades were there. So it was quite easy. Then we got an import license and we purchased Chung's retractor. This is how a Chung's retractor is. So you can use different type. They come in different length. The length, the breadth and size, all three varies, and it comes with a full set like this for us to do it. Now, to do a transaxillary, here you must understand that there is no puncture you make on the skin. Like in laparoscopy or thoracoscopy, or in case of, you know, a rabbit, you make a puncture in the skin, then the cannulas go. Here, you just make a single cut of 5 cm and all the instrument hang in the roof, which means the cannula and the instrument don't go through the skin cuts. So this is the marking which would come. This is the Adam's apple and the hyoid, suprasternal notch. So this is the axillary. Remember, you must put this incision only in the skin bearing area and don't cross this, so that when the lady closes the arm, this gets buried. So if you see that, you draw a straight line to this, this is the lowermost limit, and then you take the hyoid A-line. Can somebody mute them? Somebody is speaking in between. Is my screen seen, Jagdish?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so then this is a A-line. So from this point, if you draw a line straight away, then it's the upper point. So this is where the hyoid would be. I'll show you. There is a video. So when you finish the full surgery, you can see it just is a subcuticular incision, and then it just sits here, and then it gets buried and it is not seen. So through this you go and then do the surgery per se. Now if you do transaxillary, remember there is a overcrowding. In transaxillary, all the four instruments, the camera and the three arms, would go through the same area. Because in malignancy, you end up doing central compartment and if required, on that unilateral functional neck dissection, so all four instruments go. So there is a real estate problem, really overcrowding. So there is a beautiful way you must do that. So if you see that, this is the axillary cut. Presume that this is the right axillary cut we have. So you know there is a diamond shape opening you would develop here. So you have an upper part of the cut, lower part, and then you have medial and lateral end. So the Chung's retractor always sits at the roof. 30 degree down, the camera sits here. So now you have one hand here. You can see this is the main instrument. If you have an habit of using a 5mm monopolar spatula or harmonic, the main working instrument come here. The other end of the diamond shape, you use 5mm Maryland. So in between the Maryland and the Chung's retractor at the roof, you can use actually a fenestrated bipolar, or I always use a serrated forceps. So you can see this is very important. So there is no overcrowding. Diamond shape, roof, floor, medial end, lateral end, and this. So this is extremely important for you not to clash, because the whole surgery happens with only endoris with minimum arm movement in this, because there is no space either inside or outside, but beautifully you can do that. So this is one. Now I'll show you again. You can see that roof, floor, medial, lateral end, and this instrument. If you can either use a prograsper, or you can use a fenestrated bipolar, or if you have the instrument I showed you, Schertel grasp, which is the instrument for robotic thyroidectomy, you can use this. So I put it again. You can see this roof, floor, and see how it is there. Chung's retractor above, or if you are using a Coopersmith, then you have a camera at the floor, two working instrument to come. So this is the same photos I'm going to show. See, roof, floor, medial and lateral end. So suddenly the instrument, which actually looks very, very crowded, now suddenly you have enough space. See, from here, you have gone down to the suprasternal area for you to do the surgery. Quite easily you can do. The second issue of the arm. If you are doing a right axillary approach, the robot comes from the other end. The camera port, central pillar of the robot, Chung's retractor, main attachment, all three are in. Now if you see the way I have kept the arms, it forms two isosceles triangle. So one instrument at right angle, harmonic, one instrument at the left angle, Maryland, camera below, and then in between these two. So remember, now see this arm, they have to form isosceles triangle. So see this isosceles triangle between this. So if you follow this port, it's very comfortable to do a surgery without any clashing, and you can even do central compartment and unilateral neck dissection. So I put a very short video, but the full dedicated video is on YouTube. You can go back and see that unedited one. See the same marking I do. If you are a beginner, if you want to do a neck dissection, you can take one extra through the nipple, but you don't need to do this. Now I don't take this at all. There is so, the advantage of this is no cut on the chest wall and no violation of the breast or nipple areola, no gas, and then no fluttering of the flaps and no sub-Q emphysema. Gasless, no scar on the chest wall of a lady and the breast. So the first part is you can use a long retractors. I wear a headlight or you can use a light retractor. Just rise the flap the way people who do a DP flap. You know, in head and neck surgery, you do a delta pectoral flap. You just elevate it, go down, identify the two heads of the sternocleidomastoid mastoid. No need to cut any muscle. Go between the two heads of the sternocleidomastoid. Then you will see the omohyoid. No need to cut the omohyoid. You can just retract the omohyoid there. And then lift it as you do. So sit comfortably with a stool. Wear a headlight. Long instrument, you use it. And then open. Then the investing layer between the two heads of the sternocleidomastoid is open. Then you would see the straight muscles. When you see the lobe is when you stop and then prepare the card. So depending on whether you have Cooper-Smith retractor or Chang's retractor, tie it. Remember, the camera port, center pillar, and the Chang's retractor pillar are in one line. And next thing is, remember, you have to create a double isosceles triangle on either side. So see, this is how the instrument, this is the first vision you see. This is my first thyroidectomy I did in 2011. So once you do this, remember you have 5 mm Maryland, you can retract. So the first part would be upper pole you do, and then straight go to the tracheostomy, because ultimately you have to dissect the hole. So go to the Lorentz triangle, see the nerve and fully skeletonize it and lateralize it. Look whether you have a non-recurrent now, and whether you have a sensory motor area, then identify the parathyroid. We all know that the location of the parathyroid may be different, but they always maintain the percentage sign. Inferior parathyroid is always anterior to the nerve, superior is to the posterior. So then you can complete that whole surgery, there will be no scar. Initially, beginner should not take more than 4 cm nodular size. This is, don't start with malignancy before. Do 10-20, finish the learning curve. Then you identify that when you do a radioiodine scan, you have not left a residual thyroid disease or the residual thyroid at the tubercle of Zucker-Kandel where commonly you are under doing it, or you end up doing anatomical total thyroidectomy, embryological, then you switch over to malignancy. So you can see that. So same like open surgery, you skeletonize the full recurrent now and then go in. And when you do a total thyroidectomy, initially I would recommend 7-8, you do a hemi, then you go to the upper end and try to do. It is not mandatory to do axillary bilateral approach like the Baba approach, which you do in endoscopic non-robotic thyroidectomy here. Because of the endo-wrist 30 degree down camera and endo-wrist instruments, you can actually go to the other end. You can see that this is the trachea. I am on the left tracheoesophageal groove. Only difference is, first go to the inferior angle of the tracheoesophageal groove, see the nerve and ascend up. Normally what we do is the most common site where it can get injured is at the tubercle of Zucker-Kandel when it passes between the inferior thyroid artery based on the anomaly, 50%, 25%, 25% rule. So, but here you see the nerve below and then you ascend up and take the left upper pole last on the opposite side. So you can do with a single axillary cut without a incision on the breast, chest wall or on the neck. And the same way you can go ahead and do, then you can see that this is the inferior parathyroid seen, the nerve is seen. Finish it off. Last part, you do the left tubercle of Zucker-Kandel area. When suddenly the recurrent now arches between the branches and then goes into the trigeminal membrane. So you can do from the one end. The detailed video is there on the YouTube. You can go unedited video. So from that area till now, almost like 2011 to now, 85 robotic transaxillary I have done. Most were females. But lot of doctors who had papillary CA thyroid actually came back males who were conscious because they had a practice, they didn't want a scar. So there were male patients who also came based on the age. Size of nodule, initially I took less than 4, but now once you do that, I see case upon case neck architecture. I've gone up to 5 also, but I don't recommend it. And you can see that this is the type total thyroidectomy and all of them. Average time, including docking and fold surgery, is 45 to 2 hours, depending on whether neck dissection is required. And these were the complication I had. Luckily, I didn't have any permanent hoarseness. 2% had a change of voice. Most of it, actually, when I did a stroboscopy, was a pitch change and more of superior laryngeal nerve problem in total thyroidectomies. Permanent hypercalcemia, I didn't have. Temporary, I had in 12. We follow Mayo Clinic protocol. I didn't have bleeding skin ecchymosis ever, but one patient I had where neck seroma was there, where I did neck dissection, I had to aspirate it. Wound healing, no complication. My second patient, actually, because of hyperabduction, had a temporary brachial neuralgia. Then I stopped doing hyperabduction. Now I do something like a sentinel lymph node minimal access endoscopic approach for breast uterus and for thyroid. I keep the arm just beside neutral position. Now I don't have it. Axillary skin ecchymosis was there in one patient, very obese lady. One patient had a axillary seroma because I don't keep a drain. So I had to aspirate in two patients which required a couple of aspirations. These were the complications I had. All the patients, I use 6 hours later parathyroid hormone. And if the parathormone is less than 10 picograms, then I know supplementation is required. If it is more than 10 picograms, because we know parathormone half-life is 12 minutes. So if vascularity is maintained, then I discharge the patient daycare immediately. Otherwise, I keep and I follow this graded response of para, you know, Mayo Clinic protocol in managing this patient. So most of the patients are daycare except total thyroidectomy with central compartment where PTH on after 6 hours was less than 10 pico, then I kept them until calcium is stabilized. This is actually published. The large series which we have done have already been published in JMAS journal. You can go back and read. All the tips and tricks I told of gasless transaxillary is mentioned in that. So the take-home message is it is feasible and safe. There are more than one way. Jagdish is going to show other different ways which he does. Single hidden incision, so there is no cut on the chest wall, breast or nipple. No gas required, so no complication of skin or gas or subemphysemas. Manipulation easy if you follow the port placement, isosceles triangle I showed. Three-dimensional magnification compensates, reduce surgical complication, faster recurrence. But there is no evidence any endoscopic or robotic is superior to conventional as far as outcome is concerned, other than the cosmetic outcome that there is no scar on the neck. It's very important to understand. If you do a good open surgery, if your patient is not worried about a scar in the neck, please go ahead and do it. Don't do anatomical total thyroidectomy in malignancy. Do an embryological total thyroidectomy. Don't underdo a tubercle of Zuckerkandel. Thank you very much. Remember, don't get carried away with a robot. It is your ultimate skill and training which is more important. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Somshekhar. Beautiful presentation. Just a couple of comments. You know, I did around 10 transaxillary thyroidectomy, doctor. Place the Chung's retractor, which becomes unstable during the course of surgery. What you'd like to tell us about that?
See, you know that with Chung's retractor, there is one extension rod. Like, you know, I don't know whether you got it or not. Initially, you know, when you use a gun, there is a silencer which comes with the revolver. With Chung's retractor, there is one extension arm. If you put that extension arm, it is just hanging. It is not fixed. It is not tightened. So, you know, there are two pillars. One is you fix it to the left side table, the type of the bolt and neck you use. Then you have a horizontal rod. Then there is one extension piece over that. If you use that, you get a length up front and it becomes stable. So then I didn't have this stability problem.
Jagdish, did we use this extension arm in our cases?
Yeah. Extension rod is there with you, sir.
Okay.
That is a loose rod in the middle. Okay. It is always a problem. I think Chung retractor is not very perfect, and someone should devise a better retractor, I think. Unlike the TORS retractor, it's not very stable. It takes a lot of time and difficult to do that.
Anybody has experience with Coopersmith? Have you tried, Dabas, have you tried Coopersmith?
So I have not tried. The people in Brazil, they try for neck dissection. This is much stronger than the Chung retractor.
Correct. And they say it is very stable.
Yeah,
but at that moment, I couldn't get that, and it was $2,500 more, so a little bit, you know.
But
my hospital
now, a lot of Indian surgeons are doing. We can make it easily and a stronger one as compared to this.
That's correct, and a low cost also.
Yeah, we should find someone to build.
Correct. But anyway, ultimately, it is the instrument placement at the angle and the ports. Half the job is done. Then it is your skill. once you start doing, then you start venturing, and then you find it surprisingly easy. When other people are watching, they feel it is so easy, but when I try to do it, why is it not coming? It is something which you would master after some time.
And for the listeners, I think it's important that the first 15 or 20 should be mentored, you know, because it looks easy on a video, but it's actually not so easy. So there is a steep learning curve, as Dr. Somshekhar said. So I think it's better to get yourself mentored for at least first 20 cases or so.
Absolutely, absolutely. This is one surgery which should not be taken lightly, because this is not for a better clinical outcome, unlike other place where you do robotic, cosmetic. And remember always, if you are not able to do, the conversion is totally different area cuts. So you end up giving this and this other. So select your case well. Non-malignancy, hemithyroidectomies, you start doing. Once you get a grip, then you start doing subtotal totals. Then you go to malignancy small, and then sort of, and you audit it. It's very important that when you do total thyroidectomy with robot or endoscopic, when you do a iodine scan, you will be surprised that all these years you have been doing, and your nuclear medicine guy says, sir, I don't see an uptake in the thyroid bed. Now suddenly you start seeing an uptake. So you need to master that. You with the fear of the nerve in robotic, initially you underdo in tubercle of Zucker candle. If you overdo, you end up with a little change of voice. So reach that right competency by about 10-15 case, and then you will be comfortable.
And I think it's not only about the exposure, it's the way you use the instruments. As Dagdish used to tell me, these are very, you know, tough instruments, and you have to be very delicate with them. So I think robotic surgery involves correct usage of these instruments, which is very, very different from the routine, either endoscopic or an open surgery.
Dr. Somshekhar, there are two, three questions in chat, if you can address them.
Yeah, what I'm telling is, should we address it last with help of Dr. Amit Agarwal once they both win? Because sometimes there is an overlap of topics, and my question might have been answered by Jagdish or Dabas. Maybe we finished all three, and then Dr. Amit Agarwal can coordinate all the questions with all the people.
Yeah, can sure. I quickly? I've got a few chat questions. If Chung retractor is not available, it's already answered. What is the protocol of drain placement in cases of neck dissection?
I don't place a drain, but if you do a neck dissection, definitely you, Jagdish always places. Total thyroidectomy, central compartment, I don't place. But if I do a functional neck dissection, I place it.
Can we use the Thompson retractor for thyroidectomy, or Kalker retractor, somebody has asked.
For robotic, no, because this is a gasless technique. So, you know, when you use a gas technique, you have a lot of maneuverability. But
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Somshekhar. I think we can move on to the next presentation by Jagdish.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm just presenting now.
So Jagdish is an eminent robotic surgeon. I think no area in the body he cannot approach with a robot. So right from thyroid to colon to kidney. So he is a great mentor as well, which I can say from my personal experience. So let's hear Jagdish.
Oh, one second. Just excuse me, just one second.
Yeah, no problem. Take your time.
Yeah. So, can you see, sir?
Yeah, we can see, but not the first slide. This is the first?
Yeah. So, myself and most of us, and Dabas also, most of us regarding thyroid, we never wanted to do these surgeries, but because of the cosmesis and the patients demanding it, we had to take it up. So we started initially with retroauricular, transaxillary, and so many other different techniques. And transaxillary, I had to go to Chung and learn it. And of course, we used to go there to know whether we are doing properly or not. So initially we started off with transaxillary, then sometimes intra-auricular, and then I saw some Japanese surgeons doing transoral. I think so thyroid robotic surgery is a surgeon's plight and patient delight, and it is very tough to do. Normal open surgery we do in half an hour, and this takes two times. Sometimes we feel what the hell we are doing, but the final result of Cosmesis is definitely worth it. Of course, the cost is almost 2 to 3 times more, especially when we use a harmonic scalpel. So we learned transorally on our own. Just saw went to Seoul where I saw Japanese surgeons doing it. Then adopted it. That time nobody was doing. Then we usually limit ourselves to less than 4 centimeters, and it requires very expert anesthetist. And almost all cases were benign cases. And we published a series of transoral thyroidectomy also. This is a port placement of doing it, and the robot is docked from the side. You can see here, and we usually use two arms and one camera port, and this is an older one, the robo, and that's how it's docked. I hope it is seen properly. That is a docking, and that is a port placement. Then the specimen is taken out through the gingivobuccal sulcus at the end. That is the way the specimen is taken out. The scar is excellent, and Cosmesis is very good. But if the jaw is very large and very difficult to negotiate the robo, so we have to assess the patient how much of neck extension is possible, and then see the jaw, and then before surgery only, and then decide which approach to do. I usually don't do transoral as a choice. Only few patients who desire these things we had to do. It is really strenuous. And we had to use, because the vessel sealant doesn't have endovrist, harmonic is better. I'll show some video because I have been asked to show steps of both the surgeries, rabbit as well as the transoral. I'll show in the video how to do that, in the steps of doing these surgeries. Then I shifted to robotic bilateral axillary and breast approach. This I used to do laparoscopy because of the cost problem. Our center, the laparoscopy cost only 20,000, whereas the robotic cost almost 1,20,000. So I used to do laparoscopy for the sake of the budget. These are the port placements of the rabbit. I think Amit sir have been very fortunate to have associated with his department where so many thyroids we have done there, and it's really mutual learning there. And associating with intellectuals is very tough, and we are very happy learning there. So these are the port placements. Then I'll show in steps also the video how to do it. Then the saline is injected around. There are Sandeep does it in Bangalore. He uses a small incision and then uses a retractor and elevate. We use a spacer or elevator, whatever. And this is a port placement from front as well as from the side. So all the forearms are used. We can use a bipolar cautery in case of rabbit or labbit. Whereas transaxillary, usually we are forced to do a harmonic scalpel. These are the steps of rabbit, 4 ports, subcutaneous saline injection. You can use a spacer if you are used to that, or like a small incision like Sandeep Naik does. Flap is elevated, midline cut is done. The thyroid lobe is dissected, superior port pedicle is tackled, then middle thyroid vein. Then the ITA and RLN dissection is done. Then the off the tracheal lobe dissection, Berry's ligament dissection, transect the opposite isthmus, positive pressure, and check for oozing and deliver the specimen. These are the steps of surgery. I'll just show the video. This is a video of rabbit technique. The port placements I have shown in the picture. This is the flap elevation. This is the first, initially when we use a spacer, we use a hand harmonic, laparoscopic harmonic scalpel just for elevation of the flap. We can do with the ports also, but we need to create some space. So this is how we create. If you use cautery, it looks like this, but if you use harmonic, it looks very nice. So we usually use a harmonic, and from the opposite side retraction is given. This is the first step. First is the port placement, either with subcutaneous saline and then spacer, then slowly insertion of the right axillary port and the right breast port, and from the left side we elevate the skin, and usually during this elevation the neck skin flap, we should put a mop on that and keep wetting it so that cautery burns are not done. Then if you go, This is a midline. This is a midline. You can see here. That's the mid part of the neck. So from above, we feel the thyroid notch. See where we are going. Then from down suprasternal notch, till that the flap is elevated. We can use a bipolar scissor or harmonic, whichever. But I think scissor will do well. Then you can see once we see the thyroid, the prograsp or cardias forceps is used on the right side, and the thin film is dissected. I hope the video is okay, sir. Yeah,
it's fine.
Then we elevate the scissor. Then we from the trachea, the thyroid lobe, and thyroid lobe from the sternomastoid is elevated. You can see here the third the prograsp or the cardia, whichever is available, is retracting the sternomastoid. Then we look for the middle thyroid. Usually middle thyroid, many 1/3 to half, 50% of the cases, I have not seen middle thyroid in many cases. So then I look for the middle thyroid, then go on to the superior pedicle. You can dissect the superior pedicle there. Take care that you're not very close to the superior laryngeal nerve. This you elevate the plane between the superior pedicle and the trachea here. Use a prograsp or cardias to dissect it and develop a plane there. If you go in a proper plane, the bleeding is very less. You can see nice vessels there and offshoot of a branch there. And then this is a thin film. This needs to be dissected first, medially as well as laterally, and make the pedicle thin. We should not do a chunk ligation. And I think scissor is better, I felt, in rabbit, and less expensive also. So you can see there, that is the superior pedicle. Once the superior pedicle is tackled, then I go on to the inferior thyroid vein. So there it is cauterized. Then we go in a minute, this is the superior actually. This is the inferior thyroid vein. You can see here, inferior thyroid vein. We do a small dissection, identify the vessel is going like this. Because of the magnification, we can see it better actually. And it is coagulated with a very low setting of the bipolar. We should not cross 22, 23 like that. We should be very small, very cautery. If you're not comfortable, you can better use a harmonic. But as you all know, harmonic cost 60,000, or in a SI it costs around 25,000. It comes for 10 cases, whereas in XI it's a single use. So we use a bipolar. Then the third arm is used to lift up the inferior pole of the gland. There you see the RLN as well as the recurrent laryngeal nerve as well as the inferior thyroid artery. You have to be very slow, very gentle, very careful. These instruments are very heavy, but they should be handled like a baby. So slowly you should go in, and then I think, I'm sorry, the title has overlapped. Then we go inside, we identify the inferior thyroid artery. Till we find out the RLN, we should not play around the inferior thyroid artery. So usually inferior thyroid artery, its title has overlapped, and I hope it is seen properly. That's the inferior thyroid artery, and this is the recurrent laryngeal nerve here. An inferior thyroid artery is hooked there, and we go on for the small vessels and as close to the gland as possible. And that's how we elevate that the inferior thyroid artery there. This is very close to the gland, and it is usually 5 times, or we can magnify up to 8 times also with the robo. This is not the usual small vision. We are going very close to the gland here. Can see small branches we are doing there. I think next time I should remove this title here.
Yeah.
That's a very important step actually. So the small adventitia in tissue is dissected there. Then you can see there, the nerve is coming underneath there. So we are not using cautery here. You can see here. I think hope it is seen, sir.
Yeah, nerve is nice.
Nerve is seen there, and there's an inferior thyroid artery. So you can see how nicely it is possible with the robo. Because of the magnification, and proper planes, we can see nicely the infiltrated artery, and we are going very close to the gland. This is almost 6 times magnified, so you see them all in last view. And then be away from the RLN. Very, very rarely you should use a monopolar cautery, and use a bipolar cautery. It is a very, very low setting, and keep the nerve away. Like I'm using the scissor and pulling the RLN away, and then cauterizing. And 1 or 2 spurts of cautery. If you're not comfortable, you can always use a Harmony scalpel, which has a lesser incidence of the nerve injury. Then once you identify the nerve is preserved there, ITA is taken care. Now the next tip is we should lift it off the trachea. First we should lift it off the trachea, then hold the lower pole of the thyroid in the third arm, and then dissect the nerve. You will now go over to the Berry's ligament there. So this is over the trachea. Is over the trachea using a small spurt of monopolar there, and then the Berry's ligament will come here. Here you have to be very slow and very gentle. Usually there will always be a small vessel here. You can see here there's a small vessel here. I hope this vein is seen there. So this usually bleeds. This is a nerve there, RLN nerve, and you can see this is a Berry's ligament. So this third arm is lifting it up, and then these vessels are tackled slowly, and little oozing is not a problem here, but you should not use excess cautery there. Actually, I am very comfortable with Harmonic, but its cost is very high with Harmonic. So here you can see we have lifted off the Berry's ligament, and then slowly small tissue is taken off, just like any onco case, and then preserve the RLN. And after the surgery, we use a wash, and if you have a coagulant, we can use a coagulant. So this step is most crucial part in our surgery, and if possible, we should use a saline from the assistant port while we are using the bipolar cautery. So that the nerve has gone down there, and is another small vessel. Many times we have seen if you don't take care of this properly, this will this will bleed, and then the isthmus is cut, and the specimen is delivered, and you can see the nerve there preserved well. So this is our technique of the technique of the rabbit technique. There's a dissection there. I think because lack of time and the bus is also waiting, I'll just show small clip. Okay. This is a transoral thyroidectomy. Transoral thyroidectomy is very, very tough. You need to get all the assistants with you, and you need a very expert surgeon on the patient side. And because of this flappy movement of the flap, as you do surgery, unlike rabbit and transaxillary, the flap mobility is more. We need to learn more in this technique, but it's a little really difficult to do. We have done only 25 cases. And from above, we do the dissection from above. The steps are reversed here. So we go on like that, dissect it over the trachea, and use a harmonic or whatever. Then here, the thyroid gland is shifted to the midline and then dissected to find out the RLN, and then go down. So these are our two different techniques, and we used to do a lot of transaxillary earlier, but now I am preferring more of rabbit procedure because the cost is lesser, and I'm able to use the without any harmonic scalpel, I'm able to use the routine bipolar cautery. So these are my we have published the transoral thyroidectomy also series, and we are quite happy with the result of rabbit technique. This is a rabbit technique, and these are the steps of the surgery. This is my presentation. Any other questions I can take?
Good, Jagdish, that's thank the next you, presentation. Yeah.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, sir, I finished my presentation. I was told to present only the technique of the.
Yeah, correct.
Because I can't carry on too much because lack of time. And the bus is
very nice video, and I think the people, everybody must have enjoyed the clarity. And, you know, I can share that initially Jagdish and we together did 10 transaxillary, then we shifted to rabbit. Personally, I feel rabbit somehow is a more easier technique to learn, and it gives you a feeling of an open thyroidectomy. You can do both sides very easily, and of course as you mentioned, the incision, and you can use the or raise the flap under vision as well. So I think we did a couple of cases with Devas also, and I think under vision is a good technique, where because raising the flaps is a very important step, and if you use the under vision technique, you can raise the chest flap very nicely.
Yes, sir. And Sandeep, I've seen he also does a very good job. Sandeep, I
hello, Dr.
He uses a retractor to do that. Little difference. We have done total thyroidectomy also. I find it's more economical, more doable. Somebody wants to do minimally invasive thyroidectomy, I think they should do rabbit first, lagate, okay. Rabbit, and then transaxillary. Transoral should be the last one.
Agreed. Yes. Yeah. So yeah, it is a steep learning curve, and you have to reverse the steps.
Ten transoral advantage is if somebody says, I don't want, you know, it's a natural orifice surgery, like not like you go through the anal canal, transvagina. So it's, I think Jagdish is somebody who has in his armamentarium all experience, you know.
It's a scarless.
Yeah, that's good actually, you know all of them.
But it is the toughest.
I think as a surgeon, we should have all techniques in the armamentarium, but we should actually do whichever technique we are comfortable with.
Have a good result.
So each has his own advantages in this one.
Thank you, sir.
So we can move on to
Devas.
We can go on to Devas, sir.
Dr. Devas.
Hi, sir.
Yeah. Hi, Dr. Devas, everybody knows, is a head and neck surgeon, and of course, head and neck robotic surgeon. So we'll have his presentation.
Sure, sir. Dr. Jagdish?
Devas, you start sharing your screen.
I'm just trying it, but till he don't cancel it, I can't say it. Probably.
Jagdish, you can cancel it. Yeah. Yeah, Devas, you are back.
I've stopped my video everything.
No, I think now Devas, yes.
Google Meet is taking some time for us.
And I think not Zoom so user friendly like Zoom, or maybe we are not well versed.
Yeah. I think Zoom is like iPhone.
Now make full screen of your presentation and go to slideshow. Then it will become full screen for us. Just start slideshow of your first slide.
I can't see my screen here, no?
Just swap from the left hand. You are using a Mac?
Mac, yes. Mac.
So then you take the cursor to the left upper quadrant, then you will see all the screen. Then you can see your present PowerPoint presentation and then go to the first slide and slide.
No, your icons are down or the right side, Devas? Your dock is down or right side? The Mac dock.
Devas, can you hear us?
He left.
No, I don't think he has left. Devas, can you hear us?
I'm not seeing him.
Yeah, his name is
not.
Yeah, yeah, I'm there, sir.
He's back.
I'm back.
Thank you, sir.
See your dock.
So my screen is not coming.
No, see your dock. Where is your dock? All the presentations doc. Is it down or above? Come, go, take the cursor.
See, you are ready to present. You have to just go to your PowerPoint wherever you have parked it.
It's on the desktop, no? I'm not able to see my desktop.
Oh, you have to go to your doc.
No, you use the shortcuts, so your desktop will be seen then.
Just give me 1 minute.
Yeah, no problem. Take
your time. Take your time.
You know, because we switched over to a different platform, it is tough. We get suddenly first time we are using.
At least, hopefully, it is safe.
Otherwise, what you do is stop presenting, open your presentation, and then come back and present. Devas, you stop presenting. Go to your presentation, open your presentation. Now you see.
Now we can see.
So
your
take
desktop.
The help of the kids.
Now
Yes, fine. Now normally, in Mac there is a shortcut, hot corners, hot corners. You can see that now. Yes, yes, full screen. Means, yes, you're on slide show. You can see that now. Yes, yes, full screen. Now good. So yeah, so good to connect. Now let's talk about transfer robotic surgery. See, many, many I will say few people are doing it, but we should know why we need to do a transfer robotic surgery. Basically, if you talk about transfer robotic surgery, we should know what is TORS, why we need this, where we can apply this, is there a future for this, and do we have a data to support this? So let's see what is this. I'm just showing a video so that we should know what is TORS. It is a technique where we are removing a tumorous part or cancerous part by using robotic instruments, and we are using a oral route without putting any port inside. All the ports are hanging outside basically. So this is what we apply our retractor. We say FK retractor. This is very stout and stable retractor, though it's very costly. And then after, once you apply a retractor, see the very good opening, very good space. This is a prerequisite for any TORS to do. If you don't have a good mouth opening, you can't do it. So one of the best thing which I have heard in last 5 years, many radiation oncologists call me and they say, can you do TORS? The patient got radiation therapy. Now the tumor is still there. So I will ask them, what is the mouth opening? They say it's less than 1 centimeter. So it's very... very surprising to see people are asking you to do TORS when there is no mouth opening. So I request them, please send the patient before giving radiation therapy. Let me assess before you start your treatment. So a mouth opening should be at least 3 centimeter when you're doing, you want to do a good surgery. So once you apply the retractor, then the part is, we say, docking. And docking does not take more than 5 minutes or 7 minutes once you are experienced that. So now applying a retractor is again technically challenging, because the space you want to see, you should apply the retractor according to that. So this, the way we are applied the retractor, you can see that is for supraglottic laryngectomy. But when you do a tonsillectomy, you just need a forward thrust so that you can see the tonsil very well. For base tongue, you need to apply retractor in a different way. So applying a retractor is again technically challenging, but you should learn it in a better way so that you can do the surgery in a good way. So in head and neck surgery, like in thyroid, we are using 3 instruments, sometimes 2 instruments. In TORS, we use only 2 instruments, and we can use any system like XI or SI. So SI is the standard for TORS. XI, I will say, we prefer for thyroids. So now we can see we are using an XI system for TORS, because we have XI system now. And we can see the tumor. This patient is post-radiation, because you can see the base tongue. The base tongue is without any rugosity. So the patient received radiation therapy, failed on that. And now the tumor is still there on the AE fold. So the beauty of this technique is that the charring is very less. And if you set up your cautery, maybe around 15, 20, but on XI system, we say 2 and 2. The charring is very less. Start using on a cutting mode. We can say dry mode or a wet mode. And once the mucosal incision is given, then you can use the coagulation mode. The only issues which comes about in our view for supraglottic laryngectomy is basically the margins. So we always say the margin in supraglottic laryngectomy, usually there's a 3 or 4 mm is sufficient. But in a post-radiation patient, I will say we need a good margins, because this is the only last chance we can save the patient. So we try to take at least 5 mm margins. And you should always select your patients depending upon what will the functional outcomes after your surgery. So if you are removing the whole of the epiglottis and you're going to the bilateral AE fold, then the functional outcome will be so bad, your surgery is not going to give him a good functional outcome. So these patients should not be offered robotic surgery, rather than we should offer them open, we can say, the laryngectomy basically. So you can see there is no charring, and your assistant is helping us so that there's no fogging during surgery. We can see the hyoid bone. So we have to go up to the hyoid bone and the thyroid cartilage if you want to do an hemi epiglottectomy, including the AE fold. We can see the bone. So the problem comes for healing of these lesions when you are post radiation patient. So we always believe doing surgery afferent rather than post radiation helps in better functional outcomes. So I was showing you, this is superior laryngeal artery, which is always ligated in the neck before planning surgery intraorally. And then we ligate inside also. So I was just showing this video, how we do TORS. So now I will go on the next slide to just tell you why we need TORS. So this is the open surgery picture, which we're using past maybe around 30 years back for any oropharyngeal cancer like tonsil and base tongue. So now I will speak on tonsil and base tongue basically. So if you see, this was the incision planned by us in the past. Sometimes there's this incision, sometimes it's a paramedian incision. And then you divide the skin platysma and then you divide the mandible either in the midline or in the paramedian fashion. Then you go back dividing all the muscles of tongue attaching to the mandible, go to the oropharynx, take out the tumorous part. Then you have to put some flap to cover that area. And then you have to join the mandible back. And most of the patients who were surgical patient by this technique received radiation post-surgery. So the patient who received radiation post-surgery, the functional outcomes are so bad in terms of feeding and respiration. So patients were either tracheostomy dependent or gastrostomy dependent. So many surgeons, I will say honestly, left doing open surgery for oropharynx because the morbidity was very high. So this was totally replaced by chemo radiation for these last 30 years. And now if you see the data from radiation therapy over these last 30 years, what they say. So we are focused for cure. We are focused for functional outcomes. So now the radiation data says, even we replaced the surgical part with chemo radiation, but still the morbidity is very high. So if you see this, I will show you this three trials of radiation oncology group. These are 9111 9703 9914, very big group. And this is the acute toxicity arm where the patients were excluded to see the chronic side effect of radiation therapy. So this paper was only to see the late toxicity of chemo radiation. So if you see, out of 479 patients, 249 patients were excluded because of many reasons. They were not able to tolerate radiation therapy. They died because of acute toxicity. There were severe pre-treatment airway obstructions. Only 230 patients were there who we studied for see the chronic side effects. Now, if you see the chronic side effect in 230 patients, now you can see that if you see the feeding tube dependence or pharyngeal dysfunctions or laryngeal dysfunction or death, out of these 230 patients, 99 patients have very severe late toxicity. So if you leave the acute toxicity and just focus on the late toxicity, 43% patients have severe late toxicity. So are we justified in giving this treatment when we left doing surgery for these patients, replace this with chemo radiation? Are we justified? Are we giving the good functional outcomes with this treatment? I say we are preserving the organs, but we are not giving them the functional organs. So this was again another paper. We have to see the late dysphagia after radiation therapy. So acute toxicity, everybody knows. But if you study about dysphagia after 2 years of radiation therapy, because of the cranial neuropathy and the incidence is around 48%, many patients cannot swallow well because of xerostomia. So their functionality is not so good. Patient may have post-cricoid strictures. So we have seen the dysphagia incidence is very high post-chemo radiation. Whatever technique you use, you may be using 3D CRT or IMRT. Even what the recent paper says, even with IMRT, the chronic side effects are same as compared to conventional radiation therapies. So because of this, we have to think about an option which can give the good cancer outcomes or functional outcome to the patients. So by very good hard work of few people like Dr. Weinstein and Obert Belle, they started working on this in 2006, and in 2009, robotic surgery was approved by FDA in head neck cancers. So when the robot came into 1999, it was said it cannot be used in head neck. It is basically for GI, urology and gynae cancers. But now in 2009, it was approved by FDA. And it was approved only for early cancers, basically for T1 and T2. So now what we can do with this? So people started with doing radical tonsillectomy, or you can say for simple tonsillectomy or base tongue reduction for sleep apnea. And with experience, they advanced to radical base tongue resection, supraglottic laryngectomy, nasopharyngectomy, retropharyngeal lymph node dissection, and parapharyngeal space tumors. So you can see the spectrum over these 5-6 years increase tremendously. So now, before proceeding the TORS part, we always do the neck part first, and we ligate the vessels depending upon the primary. Like for tonsil, we ligate the fissure. For base tongue, we ligate the lingual artery. And for supraglottic cancers, we ligate the laryngeal division of superior thyroid artery. So by ligating, we have compared this now. If you don't ligate the neck vessels, or if you ligate the vessels, the amount of severe hemorrhage is very less if you ligate the vessels in the neck. So when people started doing TORS, they were not ligating the vessels in the neck. There was a clipping inside. So there were the incidence of severe hemorrhage and even death by doing this surgery. But once we started ligating the vessels in the neck, the death decreased to zero and the severe hemorrhage has come down to less than 1%. So now, if you ask me, the one thing which is coming into picture for all head neck cancers, basically oropharynx, is HPV. So the division is totally, the things have totally changed over HPV. Even the staging has been changed. And there's a different staging system for HPV negative and HPV positive cancers. So now, because of availability of robotic surgical system and now the discovery of HPV in oropharynx, the treatment is going to change. So I will just brief about how we are coming with HPV positive and HPV negative tumors. Is the treatment is totally different for these tumors, or are we going in a different direction so that we can give good cure to patients with good functional outcomes? So this is a Western paper from Dr. Eric Murray from Mayo Clinic. He has analyzed his data about the surgical patients for long-term functional and oncological results. So what he says, if you see only 66 patients over 2 years. So if you see the tube dependence, the gastrostomy tube dependence was only 4.5% and tracheostomy was only 1.5%. And if you see the local control is 97%, which I will say is not possible with radiation therapy. And the regional control is again 94%. So if you see the 2 year DFS and recurrence free survival is 95 to 92.4%. So now with this, you are achieving a good oncological outcomes and a good functional outcomes. So why we should not recommend surgery to these patients where we have good cancer outcomes? So this is again his paper, which says now he has segregated the data for HPV negative and positive. So I can say the HPV negative patients are less. So now if you can see, he has segregated non-smokers, smokers, HPV positive, HPV negative, and then he combined non-smokers and HPV positive, which is considered to be a good group, or smokers with HPV negative. So now from the past, we know if we treat the patient with chemo radiation, the HPV positive and HPV negative behave very differently. And the difference is around 21% in DFS if you treat this patient with chemo radiation. But now you are treating these patients with surgery. With surgery, you can see the difference is there, but it's not significant and it is not very high difference. Either it is smoker or non-smoker, HPV positive or negative, you treat this patient with surgery, their outcomes are much, much better than chemo radiation. So this is our paper, which now we have just done a study exclusively for HPV negative. And what we have taken only early cancers, T1 and T2, N0, where we don't recommend any treatment after operation. So from the past, we have seen even HPV negative cancers, early cancers, if you give radiation to them, their survival is not more than 70%. But now if you treat this patient with surgery, the DFS was around 89% and OS was around 94%. So there's a big difference in HPV negative cancers if you treat with surgery as compared to radiation therapy. And after studying stage 1 and stage 2, we went to stage 3 and stage 4, again for HPV negative, because our Asian population, basically Indian population, has HPV negative cancers. I can say around 85% patients have HPV negative. Even the patients who are our HPV positive with heavy smoking history, they behave like HPV negative. So we did a study for stage 3 and 4. Stage 3 and 4, not T3 and T4. It is because of nodal status. And we have done surgery in these patients. So few patients require surgery only, limited patients. I can show you this. 153 patients were there. Out of this, 142 patients had stage 3 and 4. So in this, few patients required surgery only. And many patients required surgery followed by radiation. And few patients required surgery followed by chemo radiation. So now if you see in this patient, you see the oncological outcomes was very good. We have seen 82% was DFS was 82% at the follow-up around 48 months, and the OS was around 92%. So the oncological outcomes as compared to chemo radiation, where DFS is less than 50-60%, it was coming around 82% in surgical part. And the patient, now the functional outcomes, yes, if you treat this patient with surgery only, the functional outcome is superb. You treat this patient with surgery, then lesser dose of radiation therapy, again, the functional outcome is very good. But when you treat this patient with surgery, then chemo radiation, I accept the functional outcome cannot be very good, but it is comparable to chemo radiation. So once you increase the cancer outcomes, survival outcomes, so this is the preferred modality for HPV negative cancers, where we are giving better cure, I can say that. So now this was about T1 and T2 tumors with or without neck nodes. So now it is, even you see the NCCN guidelines, they say for early cancers, surgery comes a preferred modality similar to radiation therapy. But now we talk about advanced cancers like T3 and T4. Just I'm going into the past. Are we justified doing surgery in these type of lesions? Can you see the big tumor, but it's a lateralized tumor involving the tonsil and the base trunk, and is coming up to the midline. So can we cure this patient with chemo radiation, or do we need to do surgery and then radiation therapy to give them more cure rate? So if you see in the past, there's a paper in 1998. This is a carcinoma of tonsillar fossa. And if you see what this is, the patient were treated with either radiation, chemo radiation, or sometimes pre-op radiation therapy. And one arm was surgery followed by radiation therapy. And what this is for T4 tumors, if you treat this patient with surgery and then radiation, the local failure rate was 32% compared to 86% with either pre-op radiation therapy or 47% with radiation alone. So the surgery in advanced cancers, basically lateralized cancers, was giving a better local control. So, and in the present scenario, we always try to refer all these patients for chemo radiation. They are not operable. The morbidity can be high, but we have to select the patients who require surgery even in advanced stage. So I will say the patient who see of the tonsil is a lateralized tumor going outside in the neck, they should be operated if they are HPV negative. And this is again a paper in the past by Dr. Jangain et al. T4 oropharyngeal squamous cell carcinomas, and it was including the base trunk tumors also. And what it found out, the survival outcomes for patients with T4 who were treated with transoral surgery versus primary CRT, there was a survival advantage with surgery. And the patient who were treated with CRT has 2 to 3-fold increased risk of death or disease reoccurrence. So what we find out from these 3 or 4 papers, even in advanced cancers, you are justified to do surgery if this doing surgery does not increase your morbidity. And for this, you have to select the lateralized tumor, not the midline tumors, not very big tumors crossing the midline. So you have to select the patients, basically T3 and T4. And then, yes, I will say if you're operating a T3 and T4 tumors, you should put a free flap. And a robot can help you in inserting of the free flap in these patients. Why? Because inserting a free flap at the palatal area is easy through the transoral route, but you want to insert the flap at the area of basically you can say vesicular area, then you require a robot to just put a free flap, inserting of the free flap is required. So what I can want to say from this T3, T4, T1, T2 tumors, basically for HPV negative cancers. TOS is a very good modality for these patients because they are not going to respond to chemoradiation very well. For early cancer, either it is HPV negative or positive, surgery gives an advantage in terms of functionality plus oncological outcomes. You have complete tissue available for pathological analysis. You can see PNI is there or not, LVSI is there or not. You can see the margins very well. So you can prognosticate the patient about their disease. And obviously the surgery gives you rapid recovery and return to activity. Radiation therapy takes around 45 days to cover. And surgical maximum patient, I can say 95% patients are on normal diet within 3 weeks of surgery. So in summary, I will say for HPV positive, stage 1, 2, and 3, TOS alone is sufficient. For HPV positive, stage 4, multiple nodes in the neck, then we prefer to give chemoradiation to these patients because HPV positive is very chemosensitive. For HPV negative, the surgery should be the first modality of treatment if the resection is feasible and functionally acceptable. So we should select our patients based on HPV status and based on which part we are resecting, how we are reconstructing the part, and what will be your functional outcomes if you are doing surgery first. So this is all about TOS for base tongue and tonsil, where we should select our patients. And if you have any query about this, I can answer you, because I will say not many people are not from head neck background. Mainly general surgeon oncology people are there. They are more busy with doing thoracic surgery and gynae surgery, or I can say abdominal surgeries. We are also doing all surgeries from head to toe. And if you see our volume of robotic surgery more in head neck, then thoracic, then GI and gynae. But why head neck? Because we started head neck program long time back. But this is a modality where we are comparing our surgery with radiation therapy. Like in others, we are comparing laparoscopy versus robotic. But in head neck, we are comparing robotic surgery versus radiation chemoradiation therapy. So you can ask me any query you have.
Thank you, Surendra. I think you very clearly defined the role of surgery and the role of robotic surgery thoughts in HPV negative patients. So I have no experience in head neck. If there's anybody else who want to ask questions, please feel free to do so.
Dabas, you close your presentation.
Okay, sir. I'm just searching from where to close. So,
Dr. Amit, sir, just end it.
Okay. So I think I thank Jagadish and Vikram for organizing this, and Surendra and Somshekhar for presenting very nicely, including Jagadish. And I'm sure everybody benefited a lot. Although in today's time, T1, T2, T3 carries a different meaning than what we were supposed to know. Thank you, once and all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Amit, sir. And thank you, Som and Dabas. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Amit. Thank you, Amit. And thank you, all of you.